various parts of Africa. I'd like to acknowledge that we're sitting on the lands of the Whadjuk people of the Noongar Nation, and we pay our respects to their elders, past and present. My name is David Mitler. I'm the Dean Global Africa for Curtin University, and I'm very pleased to welcome you to this special dinner event this evening, which is a partnership between Curtin University's Centre for Australia-Africa Relations, the Australia-Africa University Network, and also acknowledge the AAUN team here tonight, as well as the Australian Institute for International Affairs, Western Australia branch, represented by the President, Brendan, tonight. We've also just come from a really exciting and interesting forum all day today as part of the Australia-Africa Universities Network annual event here in Perth, and we had some fascinating discussions about how we can deepen Australia-Africa relations, and some of the points that were touched on related to the theme of this evening around the concept of the Indo-Pacific and where Africa and African countries fit into that that concept. And for those of us here in Australia, we hear a lot about this Indo-Pacific theme. But what we don't hear a lot about is Africa in the Indo-Pacific. And so for us, this is a really important conversation about linking up some of the geopolitical dynamics across the Indian Ocean and beyond, and thinking through what the Australia-Africa partnerships can mean in that context. So welcome everybody. It's great to also have a number of high commissioners here and ambassadors here. We have the Dean of the Africa Heads of Mission in Canberra, the Honourable His Excellency from Zimbabwe. Welcome. We also have the High Commissioner from Ghana here with us today. Welcome. We have the High Commissioner from Zambia. Welcome. And we have the High Commissioner from Mauritius. Welcome. I think that's everyone. We have Australian High Commissioners as well, Australian High Commissioner to Mauritius. And anyone else I've missed? Well, Africa and the Indo-Pacific. So we've got a very distinguished panel for you this evening. We're going to read out their bios. We don't normally read out the bios.
Which was the original Collier Pine Plantation that absolutely burned to the ground in 1957. So Curtin has literally emerged like a phoenix out of the ashes of that pine plantation. In 1986, we earned university status, and our name, Curtin University, is drawn from the 14th Prime Minister of Australia, the Honourable John Curtin, a fact that we are very, very proud of. As you wander around campus, particularly the older parts of the campus, you'll notice that it is characterized by some quintessential brutalist architecture. It's not everyone's cup of tea, but we hold it very, very dear to our hearts here at Curtin. But that was softened over the years by the beautiful landscaping that you will see around you. Thank you.
everyone. My name's Peter Woods. I manage this facility. This is the Hive, which is the university's visualization facility. The Hive stands for, it's on that banner over there, the Hub for Immersive Visualization and E-Research. It's a lot of long words, but the Hive works nicely for short. We support and encourage the use of visualization technologies primarily in research projects right across the university. So we get to work with some really smart people in all sorts of different disciplines, working in all four faculties of the university. And we do that in a range of different ways. We have this physical facility, which has got five large-scale display systems around the room. And we have a small team of 3.5 people who work with the academics to implement visualization capabilities within their projects, maintain and run the facility, run tours, and other activities that need to happen in the facility. So, what I'll do is actually, I should first just check. This is our tile display. It is 24 million pixels of resolution. It is your average desktop monitor on your laptop or your desktop is normally 2 or 3 million pixels. So having 24 million pixels is a lot of additional detail available. This is the surface of Mars. It's an infrared photograph of the surface of Mars. One of the interesting things about the surface of Mars is lots of craters. Let me just switch across to here. This is also the surface of Mars, but presented as more of a data visualization now. This is an elevation map, so color represents height. The blues and the purples are the deeper regions, and the whites and the reds are higher locations. So over here is the largest volcano in the solar system. Part of the reason we know, well, we believe that to be the case is also there's less meteorite craters up on this section than there are in this section. And so if a meteorite hits water, there's less chance of creating a meteorite crater. So that's just sort of there, further evidence that indicates that. Now, even with 24 million pixels of resolution on this screen, it's sometimes not enough, depending upon the data set. So fortunately, we're able to zoom in and see lots of extra detail as we need. And we develop platforms and techniques to be able to show and analyse data very quickly as well. Now, this next image is essentially the same location, but presented a very different way. So if I show you this here, this is a canyon. And we can also see this canyon here. It's sort of just dark. And these are the four volcanoes we saw before. But this image here is a data visualization. What it does is it classifies the density of craters on the surface. So it's a density map, and it shows craters that are 25 to 75 meters in diameter. Blue, from 75 to 150 metres in green, and then red are the larger ones. So what we can see here is that this area has more larger craters, this area has more smaller craters. It also reveals some really interesting features as well. So this one here, for example, what we believe that to be is that a meteorite hit, a very big meteorite hit just this location here, and it threw up a lot of, ejected some material, which then landed and created secondary craters. The HMA 72 and the German vessel Cormoran fought and both sank off the West Australian coast in World War II. On the 19th of November 1941 is when they sank. And in 2015, we used this vessel, which is normally used in the oil and gas industry, to survey the two wrecks. So it's fitted with what are called remotely operated vehicles, ROVs. This is a photograph of the actual vehicle there, and we developed a custom lighting system, 3 kilowatts of lighting power and 14 digital that we took. One on the left is from the hull of HMAS 52, and you can see one of the shell holes. They were firing each other and creating all sorts of damage on the two ships until they got seen. And this is the hull on the Kormann, the German vessel. And these anemones here, we believe up to about 40 centimetres in diameter. It's really a strange world down there. It's super interesting. These, of course, are marine animals, not plants. They look like flowers, but they're not. This is the turret on the Sydney. You can see that the German's got a bullseye hit right here and destroyed that gun turret. And this is one of the, well, this is the primary gun on the Kormann, the German vessel. This image is quite interesting from a number of perspectives. One is that it indicates, shows how much clear water we had. This is down at 2.5 kilometres underwater. And we also had really good sharp photography. You can see the rifle at the end of the barrel here. It also shows a little bit of the personality of the crew. So on the front plate of the gun here, there's some graffiti, which they've named the gun Linda. And in German text, it says, Linda brings us life and death or destruction to the enemy. So lots of different groups participating.
It does work.
You can. This is our cylinder display here. Now, this is not the whole wreck. This is actually just a portion of the wreck. It's a large section that was ripped apart. So the story of Kormann is it was carrying around 300 sea mines. These were going to be deposited in harbours around the world to create a distraction and to damage the Allied ship. This particular part of the ship, it collided with the front of the vessel, which is where normally the anchors are sort of held and hung, and that collision embedded or pierced the anchor into the hull, and then as these two sections pulled apart, the anchor was pulled through the hull here and started to open up like a tin can. But then I suspect that underneath here is something that it got stuck on. And the shank here is normally this big, but it's
probably could have fitted on the middle one, but that's alright, we'll do this here. And since everybody's on that row, I'll just sit here. Okay.
Yeah, come on down, don't be shy. Kaya? Kaya, thank you. Yeah. Do you know what Kaya means? Has someone told you since you've been here? What do you think it means?
Welcome.
Hello. Yeah, all those things. Mm-hmm. Now, I guess a lot of the things that I'm going to talk to you about, you may already know because we may be coming from very similar world views or perspectives. So, but I'll explain things anyway. So, hello is the first greeting of this location. It's an ancient greeting. It means a lot of different things. And as you may also know in your own languages, that it doesn't quite translate perfectly into English. Because in the English language there's lots of words basically for the same thing. And you only have to sort of look at that. In Noongar language, which I'll talk about, that's the language of this location. Kaya means hello, means welcome, means yes, Blasha Jacob Smith. Nan means me and my, and I, they're the same thing, okay, just me. Quell is name, and that's actually the name of a tree, because our naming system is really becoming prioritised, which is very important, because we exist. And And if there's a continuation of denial of existence, what does that do to your well-being? It's like, you don't even want it for them. And then that's the path that our young people fall down. Like, not important. So it's about coming and bringing about the integrity of cultural teaching. Okay? I'm very privileged that I grew up with my mum, and she was able to make sure I had a lot, more everything I needed, basically, to sit here and talk to you today. Okay, awesome. So that's a little bit about me. I just moved house on the weekend, which was a real nightmare, and I lived there with my partner. A lot of my family are around the surrounding areas of Perth. Most of my family lives about an hour south of Perth, and we're a very strong, close family network, so we always help each other.
Maya, it's a territorial. The little one, our Helena, I own this place. Yeah.
It's dedicated.
Yeah.